My presentation is going to be about what we've been doing for statistical distributions in version 18.2. And there, our primary focus is on quality control or quality assurance. First, let's talk about some context for this particular presentation. In this presentation, I'm basically showing a lot of things that were done in a workspace called distributions.demo.git.dws. And the source for that is in this particular GitHub repository. And I'll point out that part of the presentation uses samples from R as well as from APL. And those samples were provided by ChemoLunis GitHub repository, which is at this location. And I'll mention that Dialog is actually considering retiring the distributed R connection workspace in favor of Chemo's open source project. And then we'll, with that behind us, we'll start the demonstration. When we started APL many, many years ago, we did have a thing called question mark. And Monadic question mark gave us uniform sampling with replacement. So if I enter question mark 10, reshape 6, I get a random set of numbers in the set of 1 to 6. And you see that there are some repeats. Now, this is what you'd expect with replacement. Now, you can do this for a larger set of numbers, say in this case, a million numbers. And I'm doing a little bit of work here to gather some statistics about the random numbers we got. Essentially, what percentage or what fraction of those numbers were 1? What fraction were 2? And so on. And you can plot this in a chart. And this is a sort of a rudimentary form of what's called a PDF chart, a probability density chart. Essentially, we show the density of probability in each particular sample bucket. Now, version 14 added question mark 0, and that is a way of getting randomly distributed uniform numbers, uniformly distributed numbers between 0 and 1 that are random. And as you see, there's no predicting what particular number you're going to get, but we can say that they have a good characteristic of randomness. Version 18 added 16 additional distributions. So this led to the question of, okay, did we actually get these distributions right? Or is there a problem in our code? So the way you access these distributions is through the new IBEAM 16808. And the typical pattern is you provide the control parameters for a particular distribution as the left argument. And the right argument has two things in it, the name of the distribution you want and the shape of the result. Now, typically that's just going to be a single number like 1 million, but it could be 2, 3, 4, 5, 1 million. And so here's a case where we actually generated 1 million random numbers with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. And as you see, we got a million numbers. And with a short expression, we can get things like the average, the minimum value, and the maximum value. And that's sort of a quick characterization. And we could, for instance, calculate the standard deviation if we wanted. It's often more interesting to look at this graphically. And this is an extension of the kind of PDF we first showed for question mark 6. The thing about this you'll notice is the graph looks kind of fuzzy. And the property of statistics is if we had many more samples, it would get smoother. In fact, if we had an infinite number of samples, this is what our graph should look like. So to compare the two, let's overlay the two. The black line on this is the ideal case, and the red lines are what we actually got from our samples. So the question is, are these graphs similar enough to say that we're okay? What about the beta distributions, which seems to be a little bit more dramatically fuzzy? By eyeball, they look pretty close. But if we're going to have something that goes into our automatic quality assurance tests, we need a more exact numerical approach, and it's got to be repeatable. Fortunately, I think it was in the 1930s, two Russian mathematicians found a good way to measure the difference between distributions. The two mathematicians were Andrei Kolmogorov and Nikolai Smirnov. And I'll point out there are other approaches to measuring the difference between distributions, but this one seems to be pretty good and it has the advantage of being quite simple. What they actually do for these distributions is they look at what's called a normalized cumulative distribution. And this expression here shows how you get a normalized distribution from a PDF. That is, you just sum up, do a sum scan on the PDF, and then divide by the last number in the series. And so this shows a couple of CDFs for the normal distribution, and in this case, for the beta distribution. And the key thing to note here is these curves have different shapes. Now, of course, they have a different sort of span of the x-axis they cover, but the important thing is the shapes are different. Here's how we calculate a KS statistic. We take the PDF we get for the ideal case and run it through NCD to get the cumulative distribution, and do the same thing for the actual. And then our statistic is to take the absolute value of the difference between the two, that is all these values, however many there are, and then take the maximum of them. And that's it. It's essentially a very simple way of calculating how similar or different these distributions are. So for the two examples we looked at, normal and beta, for those particular parameters, these are the statistics we get. And the good thing is these are small numbers. Small means that the distributions are quite similar. If they started getting larger, like 0.1, we wonder if they're actually the same or not. But down at this level, they're pretty close. Now, that's what we use for our quality assurance test. And I ran this on all the new distributions, and we have good agreement with the KS statistics between actual and ideal for all but one. And the outlier is the Weibull distribution. The funny thing is, the results we got are a very close match for the results that are produced by the R programming environment. And R has quite a good reputation, it's been around for a while. So we have to be suspicious of the question of did R get it wrong? What I'll have to assume is our assumptions about what the ideal distribution should look like are not correct. Now, in fact, when we take a look at the cumulative distributions for our Weibull implementation, for R's Weibull implementation, and the ideal, here's what we get. Now, this is a little confusing because it turns out the Weibull and R Weibull CDS are exactly on the very same line. That is, in the way I've drawn it, you can't tell the difference. So they just overrode each other. However, there is no way that they're any way similar to what we get from our ideal distribution. However, when we compare using a Kolmogorov-Smirnov statistic, the two distributions, that is, what we get in APL and what we get from R, we have very close agreement. So the question is, what's gone wrong? This is, by the way, the APL expression that we use to characterize the ideal PDF. And we constructed that from the Wikipedia specifications. And you can do your own translations, but I think I've got this right, at least according to this. And they actually, in Wikipedia, gave what the curve should look like. So the question is, what's wrong here? Now, one speculation I had is perhaps they just reversed the parameters. So I tried at modifying our ideal PDF expression to do exactly that. And then I did a comparison between our statistic and the ideal statistic. And the first case I tried looked pretty good. Second case is moderately okay, but the third and fourth are really bad. So something with a KS statistic of 0.367 is just bad. These are almost certainly not the same distributions. So we still have a question that's open. and we need to worry about answering it. However, as I pointed out, when we compare the distributions that we get and the ones we get from R for these two, all these different parameters we provided, they're in very close agreement. So I have to assume that if we have a bug, then R also has a bug, and it appears to be the same bug. And actually, I suppose the real issue is I don't really have a good read on what the actual ideal should be. And so I'll just leave that out as an unsolved problem, because for our QA test, I really need to put in an accurate algorithm for what the ideal distribution should be. And clearly I don't have it yet. So I'll leave that open as a question that other people might want to respond to. And otherwise, I'd be glad to take questions.
Thanks, Ron. So one question came in was, are we going to run these statistics against more theoretical tests like student test and t-test?
The answer is we may do that. The key is when we put in these QA tests, we have just as much of a problem to make sure we're doing it correctly. And that means both understanding the test and making sure our implementation is accurate. But I'm open to running other tests. In fact, one of the complaints we often have with QA tests is they take a long while because we try to do them exhaustively. And if you really want to look at all the cases that matter, it can take a while.
All right. Mm-hmm. Another question is, sorry, did you want to say anything else?
Oh, I was figuring that since there are some expert statisticians in the audience, perhaps they or perhaps Stephen will have something to add to this, because I'm not an expert in statistics, although I did have friends who took courses in statistics in college, and their attitude is that it was painful. In some sense, statistics is a hard subject. Probability is much easier. In probability, you start with the rules for how things are supposed to work, and you just deduce things from them. In statistics, you start with the numbers, and you try to figure out what distribution do we have, and you try to figure out what inferences you can make. And it's not easy. Some people refer to the book on statistics and stochastic processes as sadistics and masochistic processes. So I have great respect for statisticians who do well.
Yeah. Another question is, there are two ways to specify a gamma distribution. Can I use both ways? And if not, which way should I use?
Well, what I would say in general, when we were coming up with the pattern of arguments that we had for these distributions, we looked to Wikipedia as our source. So in this case of the Weibull, I assume that either Wikipedia has got it wrong or I misunderstood Wikipedia. So that's generally the pattern we followed. If there are better ways of doing it, I'm open to suggestions. And of course, if we put in a different way of doing it, that's different, say, from Wikipedia, or which is not covered in Wikipedia, we'll need to document this properly so our APL users will know what to expect and how to use things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And maybe you can go back a few slides. There is a question, how do you generate the distribution? Is there an I-beam for it?
Oh, yes.
I think the answer is yes, and you have a slide for it.
Yes, I do. In fact, let me get to that slide. And I believe this is a slide in question. The I-beam is 16808. And the left argument is the distribution for, or is the control parameters for the distribution that you want to use. And the right argument is two things, the name of the distribution, and the second one is the shape of the result you want.
Yep. Yeah. Oh, right. We get the person who asked that question now points out that this is not in the documentation about I-beams. Are you aware of that? I thought it was added.
Well, I thought it was. However, if it's not, this is something we got to fix.
Yep, definitely. And do you know the significance of the number 16808?
Well, really, the significance was I originally wanted to use 16807, but that was we didn't want to do that because we'd had a previous IBM that used that number. And the original significance is that's the original random link that was used in the IBM implementation of random number generation.
Right. Okay. Andy says that it's mentioned in the 18.2 documentation.
Okay.
All right. So I think we have dealt with all questions.
If you want, there is actually, as I mentioned, we actually have the workspace that I used for generating all these results. And here's a case where I showed the PDF for the beta distribution. And one thing I'll point out is you have to think of this distribution as a function. And the IBM is kind of an operator, because if I put in different numbers for the control parameters, say in this case, if I reverse them, 5 and say 2, let's get this correct, we'll get quite a different distribution. So that's generally the characteristic of a lot of these things. As Stephen Munzer will point out, when we're dealing with random numbers, it's more useful to think about things in terms of operators than it is as functions.
Yep. Mm.
And as I pointed out in the very one of my first slides is the code for all this is actually in a GitHub repository, and you can download that and install it to create this workspace exactly. If you want to try these things yourselves and do experiments that I hadn't thought of.
Yep. Great.